Let's go, girls.
Hello, and welcome back to Feminist Cocktail Hour. I'm JC, and today we are getting in the way, way, way back machine to talk about Hypatia. Hypatia was the only female scientist and philosopher among the ancient Greeks and Romans whose work has survived to today. In her honor, we are mixing up a drink that I am calling a Phil-ouzo-pher to make it. You're going to need some club soda, some hibiscus liqueur, some orange juice, a little bit of orange bitters, and of course, some wuzo. Opa! While you go wrangle all that up, I am going to start the story of Hypatia of Alexandria. Okay, so information about Hypatia's life is extremely sketchy. She was born sometime in the 4th century AD, maybe around 350, maybe 370. The exact year is debated. Also, I'm going to show you some images of Hypatia, like this one or this one. But honestly, we have no idea what Hypatia looked like because none of that art was created during her lifetime. And in fact, not a lot of the work that she created during her lifetime has actually survived. So why the fuck are we talking about this mystery woman? I'm going to tell you. It's because until Marie Curie came along, Hypatia was the most famous female mathematician and scientist in all of history. That is a 1500-year reign. And yes, obviously, this speaks to the dearth of lady scientists, but it also speaks to Hypatia's incredible, legendary intellect. Hypatia was the daughter of Theon of Alexandria. Theon was also a scholar. He was actually the head of a large school called the Museion. This word predates our word museum, which actually means like a place to honor the muses. I know, that hadn't occurred to me either. Anyway, he was the head of the museum, which was right down the street from where the Library of Alexandria, one of the seven wonders of the ancient world, had once stood. For centuries, Alexandria had been the go-to locale for academics and intellectuals, in part because of this library. After the destruction of the library, which happened about a decade before Hypatia's birth, there was an increase in ambivalence towards knowledge and science as Christianity spread throughout the region. In spite of this, people from across the empire would still come to Alexandria to be educated. And by people, I mean wealthy people. And by wealthy people, I mean wealthy people with penises. What's remarkable is that Hypatia, a woman, rose to succeed her father as head of the museum and exceeded him in intellect. She was considered throughout the empire to be one of the preeminent minds of her generation. People from all over sought her intellect, always men, often very powerful men. This, of course, would end up becoming a problem later. Now, I keep talking about Alexandria, even though I've, you know, based this cocktail around a Greek aperitif, wuzo. Alexandria, of course, is in Egypt, always has been, so it's likely that our Hypatia actually looked a lot more like this. So Hypatia was not Greek, nor was she, if we like really want to get technical about everything, what we would call a philosopher, although she did preach the ideas of the ancient Greek philosophers like Plato and Aristotle to her students. However, she herself was much more of a scientist. But in a weird way, I would say that her commitment to science sort of became her philosophy. She was also technically a follower of a philosophical movement that we refer to as Neoplatonism. Neoplatonism is like a really flexible philosophy that deals with this idea of oneness. Basically, it's the idea that we all come from this one energy, and we don't have to wait to the afterlife to like achieve perfection and happiness. We can achieve it here on Earth through intellectual and philosophical contemplation. And then at the end of our lives, we return to this oneness. That's the whole philosophy. And by the way, this doesn't mean that Hypatia was a monotheist. In fact, very much the opposite. She was 100% pagan, believed in a bunch of gods, just like the Romans and the Greeks. Speaking of which, we're gonna get up in this ouzo, this Greek ouzo. We're gonna put 1 ounce into our cocktail shaker. Now, ouzo, like I said, is a Greek aperitif and it has a very, very strong anise flavor, that kind of black licorice flavor. So to balance that out, we are going to add 2 ounces of our hibiscus liqueur. I chose the hibiscus liqueur for a couple of reasons. The first is that I really try to use everything I have in my liquor cabinet, and I created this liqueur for an episode a couple weeks ago about Rigoberta Menchu. It's floral with heavy citrus notes. I think it's going to be a great complement to the ouzo. I also chose it because I think hibiscus liqueur goes well with Hypatia, although some people say it Hypatia or Hypatia or Hypatia. Look, there's like no fucking consensus around how to say her name, and she's been dead for like 2,000 years, so we're probably not going to get an answer on that. There's not a lot of consensus around Hypatia in general, although there's one thing it seems everyone can agree upon, and that's the fact that Hypatia was a hottie. I mean, the word luminous, in fact, was thrown around quite a bit. Of course, that's the one thing that survives after thousands of years. Writings about how fine Hypatia was. However, Hypatia was, you know, a scholar, and as such, she led a chaste life and likely died a virgin. This did not stop all of her male students, though, from trying to get with her. In fact, there was one student who was so passionate in his desires that Hypatia had no choice but to quell his urges by playing her lyre. I know, guys, it's drastic. But, I mean, that's what I do. Whenever there's a construction worker catcalling at me, you know, unwanted attention, I just bust out that lyre. Almost always does the trick. But this young man could not be dissuaged even by the lyre. So do you know what our girl Hypatia did? She went to this man who was mooning over her. She pulled out her used menstrual rags and she threw them at him. And she said, "This is what you really love. This is what womanhood really is." And you know what, guys? That did the trick. I'm just saying, next time a skeeve hits on you at a bar, you can just, like, you know, throw your used tampon at him. That will probably get rid of him. Much more effective than throwing a drink in his face. And that's something you don't want to do anyways, because that's just, you know, a waste of hard work on a cocktail, which we're going to get back to real quick. We're going to add in half an ounce of orange juice to our cocktail shaker. And we're also going to add in 2 dashes of either orange bitters or aromatic bitters. Either will do a great job in rounding out this cocktail. It'll be a nice addition. Now, when we talk about the additions that Hypatia made to science and math, it seems like she didn't herself invent so many new mathematic or scientific principles as she did just help preserve the work of those who came before her. She may have made adjustments to instruments such as the astrolabe and the hydrometer. She maybe created some new geometric principles and created a new system of long division, all of which is way too mathy for me to get into. But her primary work during her life and her father's life was to protect the work of the scholars who had come before them. And this was important work that needed to be done because this was a dangerous time for intellectuals. Remember, I said that just a few decades before Hypatia was born, the library in Alexandria was destroyed. During her lifetime, the museum where she taught was closed by the leader of Alexandria, a Christian. Then the Serapeum, where she taught after that, was destroyed by an angry mob of Christians. By the way, Hypatia had no issue with the Christians. Even though she was openly pagan and a polytheist, her, you know, Neoplatonism played well with, you know, Christianity. Some of her, like, most famous students were Christians, in fact. There was Synesius, who had become the bishop of Ptolemais, and there was Orestes. Orestes was a student of Hypatia's later in her life, when she was in her 40s or possibly even her 50s. Orestes was a very powerful man. He was actually the prefect of Alexandria, which basically meant, you know, he was the guy in charge there. From basically day one of his time in office, he had an adversarial relationship with a guy named Cyril, the Bishop of Alexandria, which was a position in those days that was closer to being Pope. And this Bishop Cyril, guys, is just like a fucking bag of dicks. And he doesn't want anyone who is in full on board with Christianity in Alexandria at all. So he gets a bunch of his cronies together and they end up closing every synagogue in Alexandria and expelling every Jew from the city. Well, Orestes is pissed. He doesn't want shit to go down like that, so he tattles on Cyril, to the Emperor of Rome. Of course, now Cyril is pissed. So he riles up like a gang of Christians, and they're all so mad at Orestes that one of them attempts to stone him, throwing a rock at him and putting a gash in his face that goes down to his bone. Well, Orestes is like, nope, fuck this shit. So he gets the monk who led this most recent, most violent riot, and he publicly tortures him and has him murdered. Well, Cyril is like, fuck Orestes! That monk was a martyr! And all of his Christian friends are like, yeah, wait a second. They're like, no. That monk was killed because he was a violent prick, not because he was a Christian. Cyril, you need to get your shit together. That's gross, man. You need to Google, like, what it is to be a martyr. And here's where things get weird. Because somehow Cyril is concerned that public opinion is turning against him. And he decides to pin all of this unrest on Hypatia. He starts spreading these rumors about her, even though she's extremely well-liked. He just starts saying, you know, well, Hypatia, she's the reason that Orestes isn't fully committing to Christianity. She's, you know, taunting him, like drawing him in with her paganist views. I think that Hypatia is maybe a witch. You know, sure does love that lyre. Always playing music, playing around with astrolabes. That definitely means that she worships Satan. Also, I think she mentioned to Orestes that we should move Easter because she understands astronomy. She's too smart. Fuck that bitch. Let's kill her. That's the narrative that Cyril spins, and that's exactly what happens. One day, when she is riding through Alexandria in her carriage, Hypatia is overcome by a group of Christians. They drag her out to a nearby pagan temple where they remove her flesh using clamshells, dismember her, and burn her as an imitation of a crude animal sacrifice. I know, guys, it took a turn. It took a turn. I don't write these stories. That's the truth of what happened. Look, you've earned a drink. I know, it got real dark real fast. We're gonna add our ice into our cocktail shaker, and we're gonna shake it up, and we're gonna try and pretend that, like, you know, part of it didn't happen. But the thing is, it did. It very much did. And that's a little bit important in the next part of the story. It's weird, but, like, it is likely that it is this last chapter that is actually the reason that her story has survived and endured after millennia. I mean, even in antiquity, she was remembered. Her story, bizarrely, was probably the basis for the Christian martyr Catherine. Also, in contemporary times, in modernity, she has been romanticized in novels, in plays, in films, in TV shows for hundreds of years. But today, her story feels more like a cautionary tale. Many historians view the death of Hypatia as a significant event during the fall of Rome and the rise of the Dark Ages. This brutal public murder of a woman of such renown shook the empire. And sure, there were philosophers and there were scientists after Hypatia, but many of them left Alexandria, fearing that they would end with the same fate as she. And now I think, where is our Alexandria? You know, you go to Hollywood for movies, to Nashville for music, to Las Vegas for gambling and STDs. But where is the intellectual and cultural center of our empire? And if I threw out a city right now, you know, like New York or Boston or DC or Chicago, how would you respond? Would you recoil at the thought of East Coast elitists? You know, so often now, we don't celebrate the geniuses in our midst. We write them off as being, you know, snooty, nerdy.
These are the words we use for the smartest people in our society often.
Anyway, we've poured our drink into our chalice. There's nothing pretentious about that. We're gonna top it with a little bit of club soda and then garnish it with peel of orange. Let's give it a taste.
The cocktail's really good.
You get a lot of that anise flavor. It's powerful in a way that's actually kind of delightful and unusual. Unfortunately, the story of Hypatia is not that unusual, even 2,000 years later. I mean, sure, we don't dismember female scholars in the streets, but our society has its own way of putting smart women in their place. Men today know exactly what our pious buddy Cyril discovered thousands of years ago. There is nothing more threatening than a brilliant woman. I hope that you enjoyed this episode of Feminist Cocktail Hour. If you had fun, make sure to subscribe, follow me on Instagram, and hey, come back on Tuesday. I'll have a new lady, a new libation. Until then, cheers!
Let's go, girls. Come on.